Have started to come neighbors in over me, and I don't know if it's gonna be very much noise. We will see what will happen now. It's very, very quiet now, and it is the last day of April 2021. Tomorrow is it, the last day. So it's like a shifting now. So people move in. Those other have moved, and I got new neighbors tomorrow. Did I say 2021, the year was? I hope so. I was sometimes, you know, by yourself also that your thought is a little more far than you don't talk in just now. That I was already gone with my brain to something else, and already now. I tell you that there's some spirits coming through that make me be like that in my brain, because it start to be placed into my body, this spirit. So it's maybe no one I can see. If I can't see them, then is it God that want to come through? And I know exactly what I'm going to talk about. He know everything because he knows the future. So he know what will be say in this episode. And I wanted to recording something. I felt like I should go and recording. So something important is it for the spirit, as they want me to recording something. And I didn't know what to recording, but I look around a little on Facebook and Google and like that. If something hit me, and it was something, a picture I got about my past dog, and it was not that I should talk about. I started wrong, but I tell you anyway. Because it was a picture of the dog, and there was the dog attracted Arabic people, Muslims, and they were curious and wanted to caress my dog and play with my dog, and but it was a girl that was scared, so. I come and think about that in Islam is a dog something very bad, haram, and they don't have it, those Orthodox Muslims, those fanatic that is not so. Those Muslim that is very strong in their religions and almost like a terrorist, then is it very nice Muslim also that is not like terrorist. So all religions have this orthodox kind of people that can kill for their religion. So it has nothing with a Muslim to do. It can be Christian people that kill also, and other Catholic, they go and abuse kids and like that. There is religions that is not, all religion have something form of not good thing, evil and bad thing. And I am not in a religion, even if I belong to a church now, but it was for the work for God. I joined a church, but in this time when it's Corona time, I don't need to go to that church. So I have not been in the church for since March last year, 2020, March 2020. So I'm glad that I don't need to go to that church, but I can use many things in my work for God by being there, but not there. not in the building. And the girl that was frightened, why she was frightened about the dog. And I said to her that you should not be frightened about a dog, because that is not about the animal dog. It have with dogs to do, have with people that can be like dogs, very bad, biting people. It have nothing with the animal to do. Haram is not about the dog animal. I told them. So she started to play with the dog and caress when I told her that. So it's very good that I can talk to people that is from different religions. And I'm not frightened to talk about God and talk about the world, the society, and these things, and religion also. Of course, they can kill me, but I'm not scared. But what I wanted to tell you was about this. I have told you before that I was in Jerusalem, and God was telling me that I should do my DNA test, and I understood it was for a reason why he say that to me, and I when I come home I did it very quick, and it was I got the test result back in 2016 in December. And then I started to look, build up a family tree. And then in the spring, it was in April 2017, I was in that church. I had started to be in that church, and it was very nice weather outside, and I was thinking I'm going to work with my plants on my. I had a balcony in that time with It was not glass around it. In the night, in April 2017, it came suddenly a big storm, like a tornado, over my house. And I wake up of the doors on my balcony. I had one balcony on one side and another big balcony on the other side of my apartment. But this, my small balcony that I had in my bedroom, and suddenly it flew up, and it was very, very strong wind outside. And I had lived there in 8 years in that apartment, and it had never happened before. And so it was very much strength to could close the door. And then I go to bed, and it was nothing. It was like it was only like a tornado, because it lasts only 2-3 minutes, this strong wind, just enough that I should go up and close the door, and I'd be scared. It felt like someone was coming into the bedroom, something that I did not see, but it was like it forced the door to be open to come into my bedroom. So I was scared, but I fall to sleep immediately after I have closed the door. And then in the morning, I was thinking I'm going to do my flowers at the balcony, at the big balcony. So I was out, and I started to dig in the soil. I have already boxes with soils that was hanging outside the balcony. And I took it in from outside and in to start with, to dig in the soil and put down some plants I had bought. And when I was digging in the soil, I saw it was like gold. It was full of like gold flakes that was shining because of the sun was going into the balcony, so it was very shining. And now I was thinking that maybe my neighbors over me have let down something in the soil, because she used to do it sometimes, because she was a very evil person. So sometimes she dropped cigarettes and sometimes dropping bread so the birds should come and make a mess with my flowers and like that. So I was thinking that she maybe have like a champagne wine bottles that she opened, and most of some like those bottles have this like a gold aluminium folio things around the neck. And so I was thinking that first. But then when I have some boxes with soil inside the balcony, far away from outside in the corner, and when I start to dig in that soil, that was so very, very much of these gold flakes, and the gold flakes was not on the shore face, it was down, far down in the roots of those trees I had already planted. That's why they were standing in a deep corner to not be frozen. And it was there also. The whole balcony, all the soils was full of it. And so I did a video. I have 3-4 videos that where I show it. Then I took some of the flakes. I took away the soil and cleaned it up. So it was only the golden flakes. Then I go to the church. And then I show them. This is what was in the morning. And of course they didn't, and they thought it was like fertilized, or I can't say that word, but some you put on the plants for it to grow better. And I say this soil is maybe 5-6 years old, so it's not a new soil, and I have not bought anything to make them plants grow faster. I say that's not it, but they didn't understand what it was, and it was before I go to I took the flight to Utah, and I clean up. And so I had a can full of those golden flakes, and I felt like that. No one have told me that I should go to Salt Lake City, but I felt like, because of the flakes that I have got, it was maybe a half liter of flakes. So I took some of it. I didn't take everything. And to the suitcase I should take with me. And I didn't know before I come to the border of Canada and United States. When I was in Toronto, I had to have a paper to sign in, and the paper say that we were not allowed to bring in anything that have with farms to do, no soil from another country. So, and I was thinking, I have soil with me, because it's not perfect clean. Those flakes had still some soil around it, mixed. But I didn't do anything, because it will come a woman, and she, I was flying with support, so I sit in a wheelchair, and they drove me. So the woman came before I could do anything, and she said, "We have to go now. Your airplane is start soon." And then we go to the customer, and the man should take my fingerprints. That's what they do in the United States, my fingerprints. And then on all the both hands, fingers, and then he should take a picture of me. And nothing was working. Nothing was working. And my suitcases was laying there on his table. And he was going to look at the suitcases and find out that I have this can with those golden mixed soil in it. And I was thinking, like, he gonna find it. So then I have waste the traveling when I don't have it with me to Salt Lake City. So but he couldn't take the fingerprints. It didn't work. And he dry my fingertips and he wash my hands and try again and again and again and be so angry about it that he couldn't take my fingerprints. And the same was it with the picture. He try and he look at what the camera have done, and he show me that also in his laptop that it's dizzy, that picture of you, so I have to take one more time. And I think he took a picture 5-6 times, and then he say, I give up. He said that I can't do anything with you. And he was not really angry at me because it was not my fault. He was only angry about the computer and camera and those things. And the woman come and say, we have to go now because the flight is starting. And the man, he didn't look at my suitcases. And I was still thinking when I come to Salt Lake City and come to that family that have say I could stay with them. And when I come into my room, I open up the suitcases and I was thinking there is no glass can with those golden flakes. But it was. He had not looked at my suitcases, and God had made him be frustrated, angry, so he didn't look in the suitcases. That's what God did. It's amazing that it happened. And also, this is special also that I was the only one there. It was only this man and I on the Toronto's airport. That is very strange also. It's the same as it was in Seattle, that I was on my own with the man and the security guard that was an angel. So that's and then it was a telephone call, and the church office in Salt Lake City, they say that we know that you have a guest in your home that is from Sweden, and we love to have her here as a guest in the church office. And it was a woman that her husband had been a president in Sweden. And she could speak Swedish a little. So she wanted to know me and talk Swedish with me. So suddenly I was invited to the highest woman in the LDS church, Mormon church. It was something that not everyone get to see or meet. And I was to her office, and when I was to her office, I was thinking that that's where I should place the glass can with the golden flakes. And we were standing in the door and opening, and I felt like someone was with me. I saw someone was with us, but I didn't see the face, or I only saw the contour of this person, and that person was shorter than me, so it was very strange because I am very short, but this person was even shorter, and I don't know if they felt it, that someone was there. And I said to them that there is a man here, and he is saying one word for you. And he say, Missouri, Missouri, he say. I said to them when I gave over the glass can to this president for the women's, and I gave it to her, and she'd be surprised that I did it. And she said, is it a souvenir for me? Like that. I say, you should take it and analyze it. I come here for you to analyze it. And she looked so very surprised. She didn't understood, and I couldn't do anything more than to tell her. And then when we were standing there, there was a woman that was coming, and the president said to me that this sister here, she had been to Finland. She said to me, and I don't know why she said that. Maybe she thought that was the same languages, Swedish and Finnish. And I know some words in Finnish. And so that woman stopped when the president say about her. So I say, "Huomenta, mitä kuuluu?" And then she answered me back, and I said, "Hyvä," and that's Finnish talk. And I think God sent this woman because they'd be very surprised, because I had that woman with me that could speak Swedish. And she heard that that was not Swedish, and that I could speak in other languages also. And that's make it more serious about that I come with a glass can and gave it to the president to say that they should analyze it. And I think it was some sign that's for the church, for the Mormon church, something. As I felt like I have to go the whole way from Sweden to Salt Lake City. That was, I think it was 15 hours with a flight, and I am not, my body is not so healthy, so that was very hard for me. Plus, that was much money to buy the ticket, but I did it because I felt I should do it. And that is very strange that I can feel what God wants me to do. And then when I come back home, the next day, when I come, I live with a family, a doctor family in Salt Lake City. And in the next day, the wife in the family say that there was a telephone call from the church office, and they want you to come to the church office, and you are going to have a meeting with the apostle, those 12 apostles, but you are going to talk to the elder in the church office, and he have some questions for you from the 12 apostles quorum. They said, and this wife in the family, she was very surprised because she was not allowed to go in there in the church office and do what I did. And when I come to the church office, I said to the woman that was sitting in front of the door, in the main entry door, she was sitting there and she wanted to get my ID. And I gave her, and she asked me, who are you going to meet here? She said to me, and I say, I'm going to meet elderly Randall, Bernard Randall, I say. And she said she doubted it. I saw in her face that she didn't believe me. So she was very confused. So she had to call someone else and ask her, is he going to have a meeting with this woman? And she say my name. And that woman say that I don't know. So she had to call someone else that was up in the... I suppose she called the secretary for this apostle. And I saw how I love this kind of events, because she didn't expect me to meet the highest in the church. She thought I should meet a woman that almost like cleaning the floor like that. And she be so surprised, and she say I should sit down and wait, and there should come a man that should come and get me and take me to that office, because it is a very big building and it's very hard to know where the office was, and also that they don't want any people to walk around in those areas where the most important people live, the most important people work. I met many people that was walking by themselves, but they were walking in those like basic office. But I should go to the nicest office where no one could only come there. You have to be invited. So I come to the elderly Bennett, and he said that I have some questions for you. And from the 12 apostles, quorum, those that 12 of Quorum is the those people that is just under the prophet for the church. So it's, I was very, very high up, the highest I could come. And in that time, the prophet of the church was on his deathbed. So most of the people was with him and not was around in the office. And so I sit down with Bennett, Elder Randall Bennett, and immediately when I sit down, I told him that I see Jesus. Jesus is here with us in the room. And I see him standing outside a cave, and he is going into that cave, and then he go out again in the sun, in the light, and he go there between to be in the darkness or be in the light. I say, you need to accept me. Accept me, or else Jesus will not come to the church. And he will not show up. He is going into the cave if you denied me, that you don't accept me. And when I look at Randall Bennett, He was falling in his spirit. He was gone. And so Jesus have taken him. And I didn't know what to do. Sitting in a very expensive luxury office, what, and with a man that his head was hanging to his chest, and he was gone. And I have to knock on the table just where he sit to wake him up. And he opened up his eyes and said, I'm sorry, I was away, he said to me, and was very embarrassed. And I say to him, I have something more for you, I say. And he was this man that all the people are bowing their head for. And women are those that you don't say anything to, these people. And I said to him that I can be very bold in when I am in the spirit, that there is no limits for me. I can do anything when I am in the spirit. So I say to him, I have something, I have a gift for you, I say to him. And I ask him, can I take your hand, I say. And he took, so I could hold his hand, and I say to him that I am going to do a healing on you. I say that to her, to him, and I don't know why I say her. It's someone here that is disturbing me, that is a, it seems like it is a woman that disturbed me. I never say her to a man, but now I have done it twice. When I finished the healing process on him, and he was very happy, and he felt the healing, because he said, oh, thank you very much, said, Now, I say I give you the healing, the strength. You were going to be very sick, and now you're not going to that on the, in that way to be sick. I say to him, and I have just give you the strength back. And it seems like it was something wrong with him, because he was so thankful that I did the healing. And that's nothing that the church have. It was in the old days with Joseph Smith that the women did healing for the church, mostly women to women, but I think there some of the women could do it on men. But today is it only men that can give healing. Women is gone from healing. But I did a healing on him anyway, because I heard it from Jesus was standing in the room, and he said to me that I should do this healing. And when I come and the secretary for this elder, she have been there into the door 3 times and told him that he have a meeting to go to, but he ignore her. So I know he understood it was important, our meeting, so he didn't go to the meeting he should go to. And when I come out, and the secretary was standing there in front of me, I saw her face was like, who is she like that? Why is she so important? More important than the meeting. And when I come out from the office, I fall down on the floor. I was total out of energy. It was because the energy was going to inside his body. So he must have been very sick. As all the energy from me had to go to his body. And so the secretary called for the man that have shown me where to go. So he come, and then he saw that I was laying on the floor, and he took a wheelchair and took me to the outside the church office where I should meet one of the family I was staying with, that they were coming and get me after I've been in this meeting. So that was very strange. And I think they notice very much things. It's like the church is like the spy. They know everything about people. So I think that it's something was going on, and I have thinking that I should write them, because I think if the church in Salt Lake City is calling for me here in Sweden, they can't get hold on me, because the church, the bishop in my ward, he stopped me for doing anything. So he will stop the calling. I will never come to know that they have called for me and want me to come back to Salt Lake City. So I need to do that letter, a mail to them that no one, I have not heard from you anything, and that they can understand that someone is stop them to could talk to me again. And and it's not the bishop that is not his fault. It is a woman there that is from the devil. She have done many bad things to me, and she and someone is here disturb me a little. Not in that way, not disturbing in that way. It's disturbing in my energy, and this woman, she's really evil. She have stolen from me everything that was of value. When she was the one that said she should take care of my home and my cats. When I was in Salt Lake City, and when I was in Salt Lake City, she stole everything in my apartment. And I was happy that I have 3 computers with me, or else they have been gone. Because when I come back home, I never trash any computer. I have computer from late 70s, and then when I move around with the computer, I felt they were very light. So I open up the computers, and I saw it was almost empty inside the computers, and they have stealing the motherboards and hard disk. And it was very much information in my hard disk. I had written 2 books that was inside, and all the pictures I have taken. So it was very hard to find out that they have stolen everything. And they stole gold from me. So, and after they had been in my home, I have to sell away my cats, because then suddenly, after 12 years, I have breed the same sort of cat. And suddenly they start to get kittens that died. I had 18 kittens that I should sell, and 12 of them died. It was only 6 left of 18, and it was very sad to see them die, those small, few, cute kittens. So I sell all the cats away, and today I got someone mail me today and ask me if I had any kitten to sell. It's hard to get those mails, because I miss my cats. But I have to sell the cats, because they were going sick the whole time, so I didn't want to do that on my cats, so I sell them away. And so she stopped. She can, the bishop believe her, so she can say anything, and she tell she don't have any secret. She tell that she is a borderliner, she's mental sick, she took, you know, those, she do those things that when she takes buy milk, for example, then she have to count maybe to 5, and then she take that milk can. She can't take the first milk can. She have to count everything. She have to count the steps when she go out. And in the church, she also do crazy things. And she laugh about it and say, "That's me," she say in the church. And the people don't say anything. And the bishop believe that everything she say, the first thing she told him about me, it was that I was criminal. And so I joined a political party in my city, and because to be in a political party, you have to have a police scan to show that you are not criminal. So I did that, and I told the bishop I could not be in the political party if I was criminal. So that's a lie, that I am criminal. But he still believed that I am criminal. And she is from United States, and so she don't speak Swedish. She speak English. And if something is coming into the bishop office, she will know it and stop the telephone call. So I have to write the mail to the church office, to those that wanted to know who I am. And so I find out today, of course, I find out that today that I am related to one of the prophets in the church. And I was thinking I should check out if I am related to this apostle that wanted to know about me. And I had in my family tree now three men that have been apostle for the church. I have very much connection with the church. So they should be curious about me in that way, that where is she coming from? And I didn't know when I started a family tree that I was connected very much to Denmark. And this man that wanted to know about me more when I was in Salt Lake City, he is from Denmark. He is born in Utah, but his parents is coming from Denmark. And so it is very possible that we are connected, he and I, in the family tree. And I have three apostles already that I know. And then I have more than 50 pioneers for the church. So that's why these ancestors, they want me to be in their church and do some work in the church. That's why it's they that have pushed me into this church. I should never have going by myself into that church and joined it, and because I have been there once and they were so evil, these people in the church, so I didn't go there. But now I return. When I have done my DNA test, it was like the DNA test was like a button that start the whole thing. And I have to go to the church to could do my research in a family tree. It have taken forever to do it in a in her normal way to pay for to look in the database for the family tree research and be in that church, a member of the Mormon church that opened the door to everything in the to find out the family tree. That's the only thing to do. And you know that why I laugh, because this woman, she say, now she's angry. She said, "No, it's my turn," she say. And I don't. What do you want? And now she's on me. I feel her very much. And I say, what's... she say, ask me, she say. But how can I ask you when I don't know who you are? Oh, please. She gave me an answer directly. Immediately she said she was my mother. What? Now she's laughing. So she was kidding. It was a joke she did, because it was a mother, but it was Jesus' mother that come through. She had been here before. And so, she say that she had to whip up all those men. They were boys. And they thought they knew how to rule the church. And that's result you see today, because those men doesn't allow women to be involved in the church leadership. And that's what is going to be when I lived on earth. I whipped men many times. In the Bible, it's like describe me as a mild woman that sit and was quiet the whole time. But that's wrong, because I have got the same as she, that we are free. We are a free spirit, and if we don't like something, we tell. And in her time, in her culture, that's what they did. They took up a twig and they whip the boys, whip them away and screaming at them, and they have to listen at their mother. And that I ask her now in my brain, I ask her if she did that on Jesus also. That she said it happened, you know, he was telling you that he was not good all the time. He say that in the Bible, talking about to be good. That's only God that is good. He was a boy until he was 12 years old. No one was hearing about him. So I have to raise him as to be a good man. And he did. He was, and he was a clean vessel for God to place in his words into Jesus. And because of I raise him to be a good boy, even if I have to whip him sometimes. And he didn't become a good, not as good as God, but a good man. He didn't got the Spirit before he was 30 years old, and he was baptized. He had not the Spirit in him before he was 30. When I sit in the temple as when he was 12 years old, that was that he felt. He had not the Spirit inside him, but he felt like you do. He felt like he was in his father's house. Even if he didn't know God in that time, so he knew anyway, without knowing it, like you say that many times, when you, in this recording, in your podcast, you say that many times. I know without knowing it. I only feel it, and like I had to go to Salt Lake City, for example. That's a very big thing I did, and because I have to be in my father's business, so I have to go. And exactly the same for Jesus, that he was not had not the Spirit inside him. He have a clean vessel that he already had that ability to could feel what to do. So he said to his mother that find him in the temple that I have to be where my father is, he say, and that's what I do also. I am not Jesus, but I'm very like him. I'm very much in the same, like he was. And I know that. It's like I am walking side by side with Jesus as a woman, and he was a man. So we go together, he and I, in the same way. I have going through the whole Bible in my life. So that's as she showing me the hand that she's leaving now. So that what was it the message she gave us. Do you know the message Jesus' mother gave us? She was talking about the men in the church, the leaders, of the church. And no one knew that it was not a man that was standing there in Salt Lake City. It was she. That's why she was so this conjecture of this person that was standing on the left side of me, that it was shorter than me. So that can really be that it was Mary, because she can maybe be shorter than me, even if I am a very short person. It was not a man, it was she. I only saw the contour, so I didn't know if it was a man or woman. And in old age, women can look like men, and vice versa, that the men can look as women when they grow old. So it's not easy sometimes to know. And I'm leaving here now, and that's what Mary was saying, that it's not good that only men should have the leader position in the church, because women have much to give to the church also in a leadership. So that's what she's talking about, and that's why she wants me to go around and talk to the churches, to the church leaders, meeting them. I have done that in 20 years now, meeting many church leaders in Israel, in Kenya, in the United States, in Sweden, and other countries also, where I have been. Because I am a worker for God. I do God's, what God is telling me to do. And my work is to test the church, and also that I continue Jesus' work. Jesus was walking around and talk about God's kingdom. He was not talking about himself. He was talking about God's kingdom. And that's what I do. And it's not the me, because they give me from heaven what I should do and what I should say. So that's not the glory of myself, it's the glory of heaven and God's kingdom, the glory of God's kingdom, that we sit here, you and I, and talk about God's kingdom. So thank you for listening, and God bless you, and God loves you, and I love you too also.